Welcome back to our next talk. It's on hedonometry and big data. An interesting topic in which our speakers will explore the nature of language, how it impacts emotions, and how we can analyze and represent the emotional spectrum of a given language. Answering questions like, are languages neutrally, negatively, or positively biased? And by that we mean by actually analyzing the most frequently used words in a language and seeing if it carries any negative or positive connotation. A very, very interesting topic indeed by two very interesting people. Please welcome to the stage Muthu Ramachandran and Petar Kocovic. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. Few words in advance. We've made this project. We started this project 2015 under the Horizon 2020. And we are just representatives of two universities. This time Muthu was at University Leeds Beckett from UK. I am here from University Nikola Tesla School for Informatics, but there in consortium there were some 15 altogether universities and companies, and we analyzed the languages such as English, Spanish, Turkish, Hungarian, Romanian, Italian, of course Serbian. So we can just make one short and small presentation of what we did this time. If you like to know how many words are in English vocabulary, there is, I found this data on a few different sources, around 170,000 specific words. And in some vocabularies, there are approximately 500,000. So this means that all words are included in all vocabularies. How many English words in average we using for everyday communication if we are not English speakers? Approximately 3,000, but with 500 words we can make some communication in English language. The same situation is with other languages. Serbian is very hard language for someone, and with 500 words you will make communication. But what are the languages which more words in their vocabularies? For sure, on the place number one is Korean, 1.1 million words, you can imagine. And there at the bottom of this list, there are Flemish only words with 1,000, and Tokipona, two artificial languages with only 120 words. Just imagine how you will make communications. But Tokipona is something like a symbolic language, is not language with the words. But we can communicate with these languages.
Yeah, the current research on natural language processing is emerging quite rapidly, especially to predict sentiment through social media. There are a number of projects, and we were just discussing in the break, group of people, we were discussing how people will, outside of the conference, will gather our mood, you know, interesting, good organization, you know, good tea break and good topics and what people are discussing, how outside world come to know. So this is going to be much more important to identify in the mood of the people. And there are many several applications that are going to emerge in a emergency situation, for example. How do we know? So we can implant number of sensors around the building, for instance. If there is something natural emergency, that can predict that data and will let us know through API of social media and so on. So this is where the project went on with the 30 people collaborations and so on. So there are many more applications, and the how do we capture the intensity of the mood? For instance, food is big, happy, everybody happy, but the intensity of the food, it depends on individuals, and how do we capture that? You know, you like it, you're satisfactory, you know, I'm hungry, I can eat probably anything eatable, but at the same time, your favorite food, immediately, wow, that's what I was been waiting for so many days. So that kind of intensity of the word, how do we measure? That embeds our emotional feeling and still natural language processing. And how do we, another usage of this is the conversational AI to understand the mood and the intensity of the word that we normally use. So that's going to be quite. So this is some of the applications of social analytics and sentiment analysis in emergency situations, healthcare situations, and so on. How we learn, you know, from other groups immediately, instantly, because knowledge, we can't capture all the knowledge of the conference, for instance. It's a huge conference, and how do we capture more quickly? With very important digestive sentences, for instance. So this is going to be emerging and in conversational AI and the interface. Yeah. Now, for NLP to analyze, there's still number of algorithms, there's packages in Python and so on, and a lot of Azure NLP interfaces. But we just need to know the structure of languages so that we can work closely the family of languages. So this is where, you know, say family of languages in Europe, family of languages in Asia, and so on. So that will capture us more quickly to understand the differences in the languages and differences in the group within the country and so on. So how many parts of speech, for instance, in a English language. I've just read recently, even William Shakespeare, so many plays, they counted, and apparently he only used maximum of 80,000 words, distinctive words, and that's where his play. So the common structure of English language, or quite common to all languages, is the nouns, adjectives, adverbs, verbs, prepositions, pronouns, conjunctions, and interjections. So this is quite useful for us to identify the commonality of languages, group of families of languages.
But in Serbian language, we have two groups more. I don't know how to translate in English, uzvici and rečice, but small words, and I don't know. We have 10, but we will not use in any language all those type of words. In English language, we have 80,000 nouns. This is 37%. Verbs 60,000 to 100,000, and adjectives only 4,800. So we must calculate with some of them if we like to make emotions. Not only nouns, verbs or adjectives are part of our study.
Yeah, in this we can classify the in English language, nouns only 80,000. As I mentioned, William Shakespeare, he combined, only used 80,000 distinctive words in his writing. So that's quite interesting and astonishing results to know. Next thing we need to do is the, this is a global language processing. So therefore, if you are developing AI-based apps or tools, so we can plug in this global linguistics API so that you can deliver, customize more quickly, more rapidly to different parts of the world. So that's the idea, big idea behind the project. So one another thing we want to know is the what we call lexical distances. So that is the colloquial differences and the commonality of the linguistic usage. So it's very hard topics to analyze the whole language is spoken, the how it is spoken, the word we may use in the context, it differs from, you know, say Belgrade to another parts of the city, town that we have seen. But how that can be quite hard to analyze, so that the AI machine need to learn more quickly. So this is the idea behind doing the lexical distances.
Just for one example for this, for example, in Spanish language we have, and in French language, subjuntivo or subjunctivo that exists in English language but is not so developed. So then in German language exists another type of forms in Serbian, and Serbian language is difficult for non-Slavic language groups. We have glagolski vid and glagolski rod, what is so difficult for people to understand that. I will come with the first example, how we will measure emotion of nations. As Muthu said, we have also possibility to make this for the groups. For World Cup in football 2014, July 8th, semi-final game in Brazil, and everybody is Brazil except expecting that Brazil will be winner. They lost 7-1. Do you think how Brazilian nation was felt at this time and how German? We have between the players on the court empathy, but do you see with the supporters and fans? What was the situation there? So the same situation is when we speaking about refugees crisis from Kosovo 1919, then refugees from Middle East, for example, then from Ukraine. The same context we can find where in daily magazines, for example, internet one, and we made analysis and tools to analyze such things. And now we will step through the first question, how we collect the opinions of the people, what they thinking about. Over the last million years, human language has emerged and evolved as a fundamental instrument of social communication, as Muthu mentioned before. And there is semiotic representation. People use language as a part on, to express their emotional information. And we have two questions so we have to answer in our research. First question is?
Yes, the emotional spectrum of natural languages. This is very hard to understand and capture by any technology. For instance, I might mean, wow, very nice. But another person, that could be a different slang slightly. You know, the English language is quite hard sometimes. So, wow, is quite different to, oh, wow. You know, so that kind of intensity, whether he meant wow positively, or wow, you know, slightly. You know, kind of middle in the lower end, so on. So that's the going to be the very challenging research in the near future. There are a number of techniques, however, established.
We start with something what we found in literature, the name of this term colored orange, self-assessment mannequin, or SAM. We will use this few times in our presentation.
Yeah.
We start with this study originally practically described by a Lang researcher, psychologist in 1980.
Yeah.
But Bradley and Lang on 1990 described and add more words. Practically at the beginning were only 5,000 words. After this study from 1990, we had 10,000 words in English language what we used.
Yeah, so the theoretically, since the 1970, this is the measure of that intensity of our expression, our feeling, you know, wow to wow, wow. You know, there's different three types of intensity, which is known as the pleasure, arousal, and dominance. So those three metrics.
Yes. Practically at the beginning, in non-internet era, in first column and also in second and in third, we have examples for marking some specific words on the scale from 0 to 9. So 10 different practically combination we have. And also we have three groups, arousal, dominance, and third one is valence.
Yeah.
And when people on the street on in a conference is made tests between the people, they found mathematical way measurement using standard deviation, yeah, what points can they give from the on the scale from 0 to 9.
Yeah. Yeah. So unfortunately, so far in linguistics, that as a computer scientist, data scientist, this is the three measure of expression of intensity of expression of our mood or emotions. That's the pleasure measuring, dominance, and the
arousal.
And now, for example, in English language, pretty much you can express your feeling with 10,000 words. And as I mentioned, even Shakespeare only used 80,000 words in all his writing. Now, with this 10,000 can be more positive, negative, or it could be in the middle. So that's the three kind of metrics. But there's still fundamental research to be done in from linguistic point of view. Yeah, affective word norms. That's another measure that people have luckily done, and we can get this metrics measure from a text analytics through Python packages and so on. This is known as affective word norms. ANU, also the term.
AN, we call short AN.
Yeah.
It means
yeah,
affective norms for English words. The same is with other languages, but we use English as a base.
Yeah. So there is a table of these 1,000 words in the paper that they have captured with those three metrics. This is quite readily available. This is useful to identify the discretive motions, emotions that we express in each day of our life. Yeah.
We made the extension of this. The base is English language and all other languages. We mentioned some 7 or 8 languages what we use: Romanian, Spanish, French, Italian, Turkish, Romanian, and Hungarian. Practically, this is like a tree, and we linked emotions for all other languages, and we call this wider area English wider vocabulary, because the base is English language. I will give you an example. For example, I don't know how much of you speaking Spanish, but Spanish language has more emotional words than there are in English, so we can develop especially in the field of nouns and adjectives, and we can arrange also for any specific language their own tree. Example in Spanish, for example, we call accidente. At first, I have to tell you that 1,200 words nouns has this in Spanish and in English we written on the same way, and we pronounce practically the same way. For example, in Spanish is error, in English is error, but we will write this on the same way. Accidente in English is accident, in the middle for our analysis is accident. For Spanish, triste, sad, also we collect as a sad. So we have a lot of interesting comparisons. Finally, I will give you first page from this study from Bradley and Lang, effective norms. And you can see here in alphabetical orders, some of the words starting with A. And this is the position. These are on the scale from 0 to 9 or from 1 to 10. What are the value of every single word? And all other words we cannot take into account. We will show you an examples later. In first version, it was only 5,000 words. Then it was extended on 10,000 words. So these tables exist, and we using the values from these tables before we made further analysis. This is just a getting started table.
Yeah. So as we mentioned, there's three measures. As long as we, so far in linguistics, they have discovered this balance, arousal, and dominance. Now, normally, how we express, what are the types of feelings that we express normally in everyday life? You know, you might get angry or upset. So again, you can see angry and upset, there's slightly different meaning. Now, this is useful to study how we can make the AI to learn the actual mood of people. So this is much more intensive research than that we can consider. You know, disgust, sadness. The sadness has again categories. You know, you really sad for several days. Certain, you know, if you something big loss. Joy, as I mentioned, again different categories, different spectrum. Yeah. We can be over-enjoyed. Sometimes we find, we might think he's reacting weirdly. But that's his joy. You know, that's difficult to understand from psychological point of view. Surprise, again, is so different. You know, we suddenly receive a million euro prize. How do we feel all of a sudden? Fear, that's again different categories of intensity as well. So they, so far in linguistics, this is what they discovered, or mathematically, basically we need some mathematical expression of feelings to identify. So there's similar, you know, like four axis, you know, spectrum. You can have, you know, really, really unpleasant, unpleasant, calm and excited, that kind of wide spectrum, but it's much more than that. Unfortunately, there is no mathematics to express the human feeling. You know, this our expressions are quite different and varies from different languages, different groups, and so on. So this is another spectrum is normally done through 0 to 9. You know, you go to the group to study their feelings, their mood, not just satisfaction, but general. You know, what they feel. So it's often measured from 0 to 9. Okay, how do you, I was happy at the conference in this talk. Now, that can be measured to all of you from 0 to 9 and that spectrum. So we can capture these three metrics, the arousal, valence, and the dominance. And there are a list of database that people who have done this already. So we know that word, we can capture those metrics quite easily, but it refers as well. So that's kind of metrics in a three-dimensional diagram.
What I like to say, this was extended later on 13,915 words, and we made one short program is Python, so we have a lot of Python programs. I will just pass through this because if you like to know more about that, you can contact us later.
Yeah, so another application, as I mentioned, how do we capture the mood of the people in a particular environment? And how do we know what's going on in Twitter, in various social media? So every day we are going into all different social media to know, you know, anything really urgent, family members and so on. How we could capture this? I'm doing this every day morning because I have families, you know, different places, and every time I'm the eldest son, you know, they try to contact me often, so I had to go WhatsApp. Sometimes I put the WhatsApp on silent because it's too hard. So only I click, I go to the WhatsApp when I need. So similarly, what's going on around the world? How we can spend with less time to know from magazines and so on, you know, main important part of the news. So we can do that through the NLP analytics as well.
Just short expression for example, in a few different sources, the same words in English language will be represented like those in those four diagrams. And as you see, this looks like a Gaussian normal distribution model. And we made also this mathematics behind it.
Yeah, so the next comes to the mathematical modeling, and you know, we need to extract that feelings from natural languages. There are a number of, as you mentioned, there is a code, we can capture some of the things through the analytics, and we'll discuss what we call the hedonometrics, metrics, measure. Do you want to just quickly go through this 0 to 9 in the spectrum? You can see the intensity of our emotions expressed in that form. It's a, again, can be a complex depending on the size of the word. Peter? Yes. So some of the results that we presents.
Look, I will show you on this slide just a few words related to the food. Breakfast, lunch, dinner, for example, this is the scale of 24 hours, and during the day we have different practically distribution of some words. And when Muthu came to Belgrade yesterday with KLM, he also found...
I looked at the magazine, I was bored, so I took the KLM magazine. First, in the main page, was the term emotion. And I thought that because we are working on this project, that's quite interesting. So I read through quickly, and you can see at the bottom, one of the things they have discovered, what makes us happy when we are flying. You know, I know there is a fear. Yeah, there is always, no matter even though how many years of experience, we still have that fear. But what really makes us happy? What do we get? This is what they discovered, the KLM. And they found out which food really makes passengers happy. So that's one of their findings. I mean, like British Airways, which I used to like flying those days. But now I feel, because they, you know, if you remember those days, if you ask for a drink, they give you a bottle of wine, you know, small airplane bottle of wine, even champagne. They stopped that because now they open the bottle, you know, I don't know how many days before, they pour you in the glass and they don't offer anymore. The extra, but that's another form of happiness. That's what KLM discovered.
Also, we made analysis how some words are using over the week, And also on this slide are shown in blue words what are new out of our vocabulary, yellow are in our vocabulary, and on the left side are totally new words. Sorry, blue on left and right side are positive, negative, yellow is positive, and on the left side are words what are not at the moment in our new vocabulary. Who using such data? This is not new technique. Banks start to use this in 1880 manually. 1880. Also police using during the investigation, also daily magazine readers use that. And
mobile phone. Yeah, this is, I think, as I already mentioned, we use every day now. Mobile phone is part of our life. But that mobile phone can't express the feeling of the people, your loved ones, you know, your close family members, and you have often you have to click, go to that particular app to know. So how we can make mobile phone much more realistic with our feelings, you know, might express, you know, in close proximity when you are hungry, it might, there are a number of sensors it could identify when you are hungry or of your mood, what you might like, what you might watch. So things like that, there is again another further research we need to make.
Now we will show you a few songs. I think that everything will be fine with this. No. Please start. Yes, do that. Seven 7.1 out of 10, one of top 500 words in the songs in the United States. They use only 7 words from our scale. Second one is Michael Jackson, Thriller. We cut only on 2 minutes. This song is 15 minutes long.
Yeah.
Please, Molim
Zapomic. Only 3 words used in the song. Which has a
no, 3 negative words,
yeah.
Thriller, kill, and horror.
Negative words, and it has a coefficient of 6.3.
Third one is a song from Eddie Grant, Give Me Hope, Joanna. Joanna is nickname of city of Johannesburg, you have to know. But this song is dedicated to all Joannas or Jovanas or Ivanas in Serbian language. Oh, please. On this last example, we will show how we calculate that. Song has 240 words, 32 of them we use for our analysis, three parameters what we show you, and here is the result, 6.297 is score for example, this song. And final example is?
Yeah, 10 commandments when you analysed. Out of that three metrics categories, we only got 6.6 for the 10 commandments.
And there are bad words, not murder, we have murder, steal, etc., etc. This is the reason why result is bad. Not steal is not part of our analysis, but only steal, murder, etc., etc.
Yeah.
So that's all, folks.
Thank you very much for listening. Any questions?
Thank you very much for the wonderful presentation. Only one question. Can you tell us a bit more about the sophisticated way of selecting the songs and examples which you analyzed?
Look, we had some 20 songs,
yeah?
And we took just those three. And I made one very stupid mistake 2 days before our participation here. I invite one group to join us on the stage, but last night they were in a discotheque in Novi Sad, and so we miss full, let's say, arrangement of our presentation. How we select the song, we have really a lot of songs, including Bora Čorba here, Bora Čorba and Eddie Grant, but those three, we think that those three songs were nice for wider population.
Almost everybody knows.
Yes.
Them, yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. Unfortunately, we don't have enough time for a bit more questions, but any of you guys, you're free, that you're live here, you're free to catch Petar and Muthu outside, and also contact them via email to ask additional questions. So thank you guys very much.
Thank you. A certificate of appreciation for your
presentation.
Thank you
very much. Stay tuned. After the jingle, we will have our next talk by Milena Georgievich from TX Services.